We are now about beginning our fourth workshop that is themed Iron Sky. And now we will have two speakers. We will have Samuli Torssonen, who's a filmmaker and a film producer, and he has specialized on digital effects, and he's famous of Star Trek series. That was his first feature film, and later he has also produced Iron Sky, this science fiction film about moon Nazis. And then we have Veijo Hietalo from University of Turku. Veijo Hietala is from the media studies. He works there as a lecturer, senior lecturer, and he has authored 7 books and numerous academic and popular articles on cinema and television. And Veijo Hietala will interview Samuli Torssonen in this workshop, and we will also have lots of movie samples included. So, please.
Well, hello, and thank you for asking me here. I'm always eager to talk about myself and what I've done. How many of you have seen Iron Sky? Okay, good. And how about Star Trek? Who has seen it? Okay, good. I'm going to talk about a little bit about the visual effects, not a little bit, and about the film project in general, and what has led to this point, I think what is also motivating me. I think that's also interesting topic, and let's see how this new PowerPoint works. It shows me the preview here. The next, yeah, this is much better than the open source version. Sorry to say that, but yeah. So here I am. I think I was about 18 years old, and this was my first blue screen ever, because we were doing these Star Trek films. Actually, I think it was 92 when I started doing this, and number 5 was actually the first one that we thought that, hey, I can act. Let's go in front of the camera, and because it's fun. And I asked my mom to create these uniforms, and also Rudi Airisto, who was my classmate, he said that do you know that they are shooting this new Wing Commander game against blue screen, and that they are replacing the backgrounds, and they are creating these virtual sets. And I thought, well, if they are doing it, well, we can do it also. And I asked this blue sheet from my mom, and it fit really well to my room, and then I started to ask my friends to act in the film one by one, of course, because the blue screen was so small, so it could only fit one actor at a time, which of course led to the fact that the actors really didn't understand what they were part of, because they didn't have the other actors, and I just told them their lines, because I was too afraid that maybe it will go online or something like that, so I just said their lines, which was a little bit stupid, because in order to be an actor, it's very crucial to know what the other actor is saying, but it was a funny experience to all the guys. And And I think they didn't really understand what they were getting into, especially Timo Vuorensola, who is the director of Iron Sky, and he also wanted to be part of the first Star Trek with actors, and he was surprised when he saw the end result in 97, yeah. And that led to the big Star Trek film, which that took 7 years to do. Of course, we didn't know that it's going to take 7 years to do, but I kind of kept always telling our team that it will be ready next year. It will be ready, trust me. And I kept telling that many, many years. And finally, in 2005, we finished the film, and as promised, we put the film as a free download, and it was taken very well. Of course, real filmmakers said that this isn't a real film because it's not shot on film. Yeah, that was our first comment when we went to this film festival, that it's not a real film because it's not shot on film. Well, today, almost every film is shot on digital cameras, and only few people use film. That led also, well, this is actually a screenshot from the studio from my mom's apartment. She was pleasantly surprised that we spent 7 years there, almost 7 years, because she didn't need to worry about if we are going to have some beer or something like that. So we were there, and she had company there. I brought my friends there, so it was kind of a, and she also supplied all the food. So yeah. So
did she understand? Did she understand what you were doing?
Yes, she understood at least partially because she had seen the previous film, and so she understood that we are going to replace the blue color with backgrounds, actually during the couple of last years I bought my own flat, and here's the director Timo Vuorensola and Atte Joutsen, the co-director, and I didn't see that much of sun because that was kind of the first first thing I noticed in this flat, and it was kind of required that I have enough space to set up a blue screen there, and of course it needed to be quite cheap place. And here is actually my kitchen. I only had 5 computers or something like that to render all the visual effects, although it helped that there was 7 years to calculate the visual effects, so it was a really big bonus. But at the last couple of months, actually, I told all of my friends that please bring your computer to my place because I'm going to need your calculation power in order to finish the visual effects. And some of these computers are still in, well, not the computers, but the boxes, the cases are in use. But yeah, then began the Iron Sky after Star Trek, and Star Trek was a kind of school for us. It was because we did it, well, we did almost every mistake we could, so it was a kind of good starting point for Iron Sky, which was we knew that we need to use all the things we have learned and just make everything bigger this time, and it was soon decided that we need professional actors, and of course the project grew and grew all the time, I thought that it's also a wise idea to take a role as a supervisor of visual effects, which means that I'm responsible for gathering the team who will build the visual effects, the artists, and organize the production. So Blindspot Pictures took the actual film production, and I was kind of concentrating on the visual effects side, which always has been my greatest passion. Well, filmmaking is also a passion of mine, but I kind of enjoy mixing these two together. I have some any questions so far?
I think you have answered all my questions already. Could you say something more about this? If you go back to the Star Trek series, so you started very young. You are still very young, but you started very young doing films, making films, and. I saw your, or I heard your interview on the radio or on television, where you said that you wanted to, you were a fan of Star Trek.
Yes,
as a boy,
and still
and you still are, and you just wanted to make something more about it because you could you describe your work or your attitude then as. Maker of fan fiction, you know, fan fiction is born or its origin is in the fan community when they want to make something more about their object. So, were you actually a maker of fan fiction?
Yes. I think Star Trek was. I think it was the first Star Trek fan film ever created and put online. And there, even the big, because Star Wars fan films were really starting to grow at that point. And in 2005 and afterwards, there were really many, many fan films produced. And Star Trek was really one of the first, especially the number 5, which was released in 97. Back then, there was really no fan films out there because the fact was that at that point we did all the visual effects on, it was I think 200 megahertz Pentium processor, single core of course, and because now we are talking about at least 3000 megahertz, and of course megahertz is only one thing that makes your computer powerful, but it was really the cell phones are now much faster than the computers we did Star Trek on. So that I think that has always been, I think, one of the biggest things that drives me forward, because there are always new possibilities, because new technology comes, and I'm always, okay, now it takes only 5 minutes to do this job, before it took 1 hour. It's awesome, and it's kind of I always enjoy that, and always kind of seen this and watched for new technologies that might help me, and it's some hate technology and some hate because film has been turned into one big digital mess, and some say it's not anymore art at all, but I've always kind of enjoyed that there is this possibility to modify anything. And of course, the key thing here in the fan films is that you can do it cheaply. It's if you just have time. But of course, quite few people have 7 years to put in one film. And sometimes I really thought that, is this wise? I have put 4 years, and I still I don't have exact information how long this will take. Actually, I was unemployed 3 years before the film was ready. So ultimately it turned out well. And the hobby, the fan film, became my job. So yeah, it's a.
But anyway, originally you were just a bunch of amateurs who were.
And still are amateurs.
Still are amateurs. You had a big dream. You were amateurs, and you had a big dream. You wanted to make a real film Or was it your original idea to make a long film, feature film?
Well, Star Trek wasn't originally meant to be a feature film. It was meant to be just 20-minute short film, but soon we realized that well, we want to tell about more about this character, and we just filmed these small segments of the film, and finally, I think in 2003, we put the first cut together, and it's more than 2 hours. Okay.
It's feature film.
It grew much bigger than we estimated.
Anyway, 7 years school. Yeah. You said that it was your school of filmmaking, this 7 years project, and I know that using 7 years for making one film, you would not be a Hollywood's dream bunch, because I think that in Hollywood they don't like people who spend 7 years making one film. I think 7 months might be much wider option, but now I have heard that you have connections to Hollywood, or you have made something there, so perhaps this wasn't.
Yeah, it's. I think Hollywood is something. Well, if you're a director, yeah, it opens you so much tools. You can use the greatest assets you have in the world usually, because usually the talents meet in Hollywood, but me, I don't really kind of want to be a filmmaker in Hollywood, because I also know that what are the constraints there. Of course, people are saying that you cannot do this and this, and usually science fiction films, they just need to gather enough audience, which means that they need to be dumber and dumber all the time, because the budgets are going up. So in that perspective, yeah, sure, it might be really nice if at some point I could be part of Star Trek film, and why not? But I don't dream my career at there. It's kind of a... I enjoy doing films in my own way.
Yes, I I also heard or saw your interview on television from 2005, when this Star Trek film was released, and it seemed that you had very high ideals about this ideals. You were very idealistic about filmmaking and this connection to fan community, and you said that you didn't want to make money on Star Trek. You wanted to distribute it freely. You didn't want to sell your DVDs and make money on that, because you wanted that everybody has access to this film. So do you still have these high ideals?
Well, I never said that I don't want to sell T-shirts. Actually, that kept me alive the last 3 years when I was making Star Trek and I was unemployed. So kind of selling T-shirts and selling DVDs, that's always kind of been there. But I don't think that's evil at all.
So your ideas have developed. You are a capitalist now.
I wouldn't say that. Actually, I still plan to, because I think how we distributed Star Trek, that was the best way to do it, and because I think otherwise nobody would have watched it. It would be totally gone, and we sold actually DVDs better, relatively compared to Iron Sky. Of course, it has also to do something with the market. DVD markets and Blu-ray markets are getting smaller and smaller all the time, but Star Trek was kind of it made also Iron Sky possible, because we were able to keep ourselves concentrated on doing our films. So of course an artist needs also something to eat.
<It's> oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, but But I still believe in the that and hopefully we can release next Star Trek as well, if I'm going to do one free as well, because we also thought about that with Iron Sky, but Iron Sky, because the budget was getting so high, so you need so much money from different places, and they of course set some constraints. You cannot do this and this if you want our money. Basically, that's how it goes. And if you want to do a big film, then you need to have all the rights, and you cannot give it for free, although it's there. Yes. And I thought that, and yeah, it's maybe it's legal, but it's there. Anyways.
And so this Iron Sky was another, was it 7 year project or?
Six.
Oh, I'm kidding.
Yeah. Yeah, so it's getting shorter.
Your skills. Yeah. It was a bigger movie, and it was, it took a shorter time to make.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, it was, and actually the production was quite short. The filming actually took during 1 year, and we only had like 40 shooting days, but the post-production took about 1 year. So yeah, it's, but I'm going to the post-production in details soon.
Okay. But first, tell us something about the origin of this Iron Sky. How did this idea of Moon Nazis came?
Well, actually we tried, we had many, many ideas. We were trying to, well, the fact was that I had been doing Star Trek since I was 14, and it was a very long time, and we decided, well, if there are no other good ideas, then we'll do a next Star Trek, and the whole team was devastated, and oh my god. And then Jarmo Puskala, when we were in Sonan, and he told us, me and Timo, that he has this idea about Moon Nazis, and this is a theory that actually some people believe in, that this is true story, and I immediately, there must be a film about Moon Nazis, because this idea is so interesting, and but there was no films about this idea, and we thought that at that point we also realized that this is going to be much bigger. I cannot be the lead actor. So basically, it very quickly turned into bigger project. And that's when Tero Kaukomaa, the producer from Blindspot Pictures, came along, and he helped to develop the film. So it started as me, Timo, Jarmo, and Johanna Sinisalo. We wrote the first versions of the script. I think the first versions were in Finnish actually, and then we translated to English, and I think the fifth version was written, this new writer who was native English speaking, and he polished the dialogue and made it shorter, because again it was bloated, the whole script was very much bloated. I think at some point we could have easily done three films from the script, because there were so many ideas coming to the whole Moon Nazi theme, the social structure of the Moon Nazi, it was so interesting, and we had much more of that in the first versions, so yeah, but the political angle was always there. Actually, I could show the trailer for the film if some of you haven't seen the film yet.
Actually, could you first tell shortly the plot?
Yeah.
All people haven't seen the film. So.
Yeah, the plot is very basic. It's simple. During the last war, the Nazis, they realized that they had lost the war, and they fled to the moon, and they have been building there this huge Nazi fortress, and they are planning to return to Earth and start the Fourth Reich. And that was the pitch line that actually worked really well, and we actually sold the concept of the film was so powerful, and that really helped. But the actual script was really difficult, so because one of the biggest things was that I wanted that the main character is from the Nazi moon base, that and she is a woman, and so that it's not the typical American astronaut stumbles into moon Nazis and he's the hero. So basically, we a little bit switched the angle of the story, and of course many people were really afraid of that thing, and that was also slowing us down when we were financing the film. But we wanted to make a different kind of a film.
Only moments ago, New York has come under attack. Witnesses claim to have seen hundreds of UFOs. It's opening fire! Oh my God!
Nazis from the moon.
That's too much.
One word from me, and the invasion from the moon begins.
Invasion? Y'all must be tripping.
Now my question is, what do y'all plan to do about it? Because we just happen to have a little something up our own sleeve. All presidents who start a war in their first term get reelected.
Und fegen alle diese Untermenschen von der Erdkarte.
Shit, this just keeps getting better and better.
We are the promise delivered to all mankind. We raise our hands to one nation. We march to the beat of one heart.
The world is sick, but we are the doctors.
Wir sehen uns in Valhalla.
Okay, that was the trailer. We we all, of course, had multiple of different kind of trailers and teasers before the actual the trailer launch, and to keep the fandom kind of informed about that we are making progress, and it's kind of these things that some filmmakers, they don't want to make sound before the premiere is coming, and we are kind of just the opposite. We are making a press release of somebody dropping a pen. I don't know if that's stupid or not, but in Iron Sky, we kept quite a lot of sound, and of course somebody was irritated by that, and but we needed to keep the kind of the public awareness of the project going on, no matter how long the production took. And
at which stage the fan community when did you first time tell your fan community that you are making this kind of film? Did you have any script already, or?
Well,
the original idea when you were in sauna talking about moon masses, so you just went into the computer and told fans. And
No. We kept the basic tagline that there are Nazis involved and they went to moon and coming back. That hidden almost 1 year from that. So actually, we released in, I think it was late 2006, was just a small image that about Earth and some rocket flying, and nothing else, and the eagle, that was, and of course, and we kept our fans guessing what this film is about, and some guess it correctly that there are Nazis involved somehow, and so we that's very important when you are kind of taking this route that you are planning to, well, tell about the production so early that you cannot give everything. Otherwise, the community gets really bored and they don't have anything new to see. And so you need to kind of feed them slowly.
You have a big responsibility because when you are telling your fans that you are making or teasing your fans with these short clips or information, so you must get it ready.
Yeah, it's a promise.
Yes, you lose your fans altogether.
Yeah, exactly. But the thing is that that you never know if you are going to finish something or going to get, but you just need to trust yourself and believe in the project and just keep going. And sometimes there are some failures and setbacks, and that's part of the business as a filmmaker, and not every time you get it correct.
Before we go to the special effects side, tell us something about this concept of crowdsourcing, which is always used in connection with Iron Sky and also crowd funding. Because I think these are the most original ideas connected to this filmmaking.
Yeah, we used crowdsourcing and crowdfunding in Star Trek as well, but of course we didn't use those terms. I think these terms didn't exist back then. And
does it mean? What does crowdsourcing mean? Actually?
It means that you have tasks, several usually small tasks, and you reach your internet community and say that, please, could you do this thing for us? And I'll actually kind of show you some example of the crowdsourcing. About the Star Trek crowdfunding, that was also a funny story that, of course, Star Trek budget, it was something like 10,000 euros, and it was mostly just tape or cassettes or whatever, fuel expenses. Almost everything we got it for free. Of course, uniforms took a little bit money to do, but still, during 7 years, it's consuming money, and I think I was complaining about this, that we cannot afford to go do this and this because we don't have money. And then some fan said, "Hey, could you post your account number online and we could send you some money?" Okay, well, I think I did that. I don't know if it's legal, illegal or not. Anyways, it was a really close circle, and then I think half of the money came from the fans. So, in many ways, Star Trek also, it was one of the really first crowdfunded films. And crowdsourcing in the film, we did, of course, the actors were mostly fans, and they also did small things, 3D models, and kind of these small things, and that worked. We used actually very simple this forum that you can send messages, and because there was no Facebook or anything like that then, and so it was really helpful in Star Trek, and we wanted to kind of bring this collaboration to the next level. So we created this tool called Wreck a Movie. And we started the company with Peter Westerbakka, and of course we had also huge plans then before the Angry Birds boom. And we thought, let's get 2 million into this project. And we were trying to get money, and the money is on our account next day. Yeah, we were kind of believing in this hype when the companies were. Before Facebook, and the boom was kind of just starting, and it didn't get money, but Tampere supported us. We got money from Luova Tampere, and with that money we created the platform for Iron Sky. So we didn't get a $2 million investment, but we got the tool for making Iron Sky at least a little bit bigger than it could have been without it. So yeah, it was really kind of a important part of the production. And of course, crowdsourcing, especially during Iron Sky, it's a kind of word that gives you kind of visibility in press and in all the websites, and because it's something new. Now it's just a buzzword. Everybody's crowdsourcing, everybody's crowdfunding, it's a good to understand that we have been building our community since 97, and we have been slowly gathering the fandom, and now kind of if we ask money, there might come some money, but some filmmakers just create a project and then they are €300. I was asking $500,000. Nobody gave me anything. So basically, you need to kind of build your audience before you are going to ask money if you are not a big celebrity and or have really, really unique idea. So that's also kind of people always forget that you need to have also the people. If you're asking money, it doesn't kind of go well if you just spam your Facebook friends, those 200 people that, hey, please give me
money.
Send me money. But I'll show some examples of the Iron Sky crowdfunding, crowdsourcing, which I believe it's much more interesting than getting money. So, kind of these things that we were doing in Cannes Film Festival, you have to have visibility for your project, and we hired this guy, and he was really into his role, and people, some were a little bit afraid that, what? Is this happening for real? And of course, police were
also wireless.
So yeah, we had this newspaper that was actually timed to 2018, and of course, it was also this kind of some funny news from 2018. And fans created this magazine and put some stories into it, and
so it's a fan magazine.
Yeah, basically, yeah. And so that was also kind of really interesting, and also because when you are trying to fund a film, it's really important to show that there is demand for your film, and we created this thing that. If you're a fan and you want to see Iron Sky in your country, you can express your your interest towards the project. And this map showed where are the fans located, and we could show this to the distributor that, hey, there's 2,000 people in your city. Could you arrange screening? And. But more concrete examples, I'll show. This is the Wrecker movie. Basically, it's a website. You can set up a project. In this case, it's Iron Sky, and some information about the project and the trailer for it, and then there are these feature tasks. Me as a producer, I can create a job, and the fans see this, and they can send their shots, we call them. Basically, they are trying to accomplish the task, and sometimes, like in this case, we were at the end of the production, and we just didn't have enough time to model spaceships, because there are different kind of spaceships in the film, and we wanted to create this Indian spaceship, and we gave this task to fans that, hey, could you please design this kind of a ship for us? And we gave some notes and comments, and it turned out to be kind of a really nice. It's an example there, this katana dagger, and it's a very very straightforward, but it turned out pretty nicely, and then the community modeled it. Of course, it cannot hold any close-ups, but it wasn't meant for that, so it was kind of filling the screen in the background, and I'm sure that the fans who created this model are kind of they are seeing it in the final film and on the big screen, and see their names on the end credits. I think that's kind of much more important than, well, maybe 500 euros for this model. So I think that's the thing that's motivating the people to donate their spare time. Okay, and this was a good example. Our director and producer were lost in the they were lost in Texas, and they flew to wrong city, and they asked fans to drive them to the right city. So yeah, crowd sourcing can be also something like this, that you ask for help from the local fans, that, hey, do you know what's the cheapest place to buy liquor, for example, in your city, or anything like that. Kind of the local information, it's also valuable. And in Frankfurt, half of the film was shot in Frankfurt, and half of the was shot in Australia. In Frankfurt, we had this big scene when the Nazis are attacking New York, and we had these people running around. And the sad thing was that the day before the shooting day, we knew that there was only 15 guys coming. These were the guys that the German co-producer has gotten, and he was paying the, of course, money to get these people, these extras. And we said, it's not enough. And we, of course, again, sent this message to fans that, hey, we are shooting in Frankfurt. Could you join the shoots? And basically, the fans saved that day, and we were able to shoot. I think more than 100 people turned in, and we actually needed to say no because it wasn't allowed to have so many people. But yeah, it's these examples that actually I can show those scenes later. And one more example was very crucial. There is a scene where the main characters are standing on front of this movie theater, and of course we cannot put real movie posters here because we don't have the permission, the rights, and so forth. So we ask our fans again in Wrecker Movie to create these movie posters of fictional movies, and we just printed them out, and they worked pretty nicely there. Again, it was a saving, because of saving our man hours and days. A small task like this, and I think it's very important in the for the community that the tasks are not too complex. It's something that you can do after work in a couple of hours, and submit your work, and that's, and of course, the one big, the usual the question is why the fans are donating their free time, and how we make sure that we have the rights to use that. Well, of course, in Wrecker Movie, in order to send something, you need to accept that everything you create and everything you send via this platform, the rights belong to the producer, and that's because we cannot use those otherwise. So yeah.
Have you been teaching this
crowdsourcing to other filmmakers, because it sounds that you are very theoretical about it. You know exactly what you are doing with this fan community. So I would guess that other filmmakers would be interested in hearing your ideas.
Yeah,
about it.
Yeah, I think there have been, because Wrecking Movie supports also other productions, and it also requires quite a lot of work. To basically, you need to have your production leader there who comments the work and sends the selected work to the director, and it's not kind of a, it also requires some time from you as well as a filmmaker. But yeah, it's the tool is still Wrecking Movie, it's online, but it still requires so much work, and that's kind of our next objective, is to kind of how to make it more better and more, let's say, easier to use than it currently is.
Am I allowed to ask a little bit provocative question?
Yeah.
Because earlier this day, when we have this workshop on media machines, Jussi Parikka and Bruce Sterling were discussing that crowdsourcing is based on metaphor of bee. Those fans are like bees that are collecting things to you, and they work like a insect labor in that kind of in that kind of production. So how would you answer to this kind of criticism then?
Well, we are not forcing anybody to take part in our production, and I could ask myself when I was 15 years old, could you take part of next Star Trek film? Nobody's paying you. Actually, you need to pay something. I would have taken part anytime. It's kind of a, if you want to be part of something bigger and kind of a interesting project, it's kind of course sometimes it's hard if your work isn't accepted, and that's also kind of a, because it's a dictatorship. The director picks the best work and picks if your work is good enough or not. People are not voting there what poster will be ending up to the film. It's crude, but it needs to be effective. And the audience really need, the fans needs to believe in these guys who are there doing the film, that these guys know what's the best way to go. But yeah, it's I think we think that it's instead of bees, but it's a kind of a hive mind. It gives in perfect world unlimited options of kind of different routes, and the director can pick the ones he really likes, and because you in filmmaking you always are against the time. And if somebody is offering you, it might be very simple, somebody's offering you links to certain research papers and some links. You don't need to use the 15 minutes to search for those links. It can be a really small thing as well. It doesn't need to be a spaceship or a poster or anything. It might be just small information, piece of information. And but yeah, of course, some say that I will never, because usually filmmakers say that, and they think that in Iron Sky, we gave the script like this, and please execute the film. And but it didn't go like that. We never revealed the script, and we kept the main story hidden until the premiere. And but if your project is something that you can separate these small things that doesn't spoil the story, it's why not? But I also understand that not all filmmakers want to kind of, because they believe that if somebody else is creating these ideas, then it's not my film.
Yes, that's right. Should we now move on to a movie sample, maybe?
Yeah. So yeah, this covered more or less the crowdsourcing in kind of a concrete level. And actually, I can show the really small about the fans are running. Here we have fans running and really kind of gives the scale that there is people going on. Just imagine this scene with 15 extras running. Yeah. So we basically dressed up one corner of the street to look like New York. Okay. Swap the signs and the explosion actually was real. It was flame explosion. So yeah.
So you didn't do everything on computer?
No.
Right.
No, not at all. So yeah, let's a little bit go into some of the virtual thing, because now you have been seeing the blue and green screen everywhere, and let's start with the example of kind of I have this kind of that explains the general idea. There's a lot of other shots in this reel as well. So we had this small piece of moonscape, and we needed to extend that, of course, and create the elements beyond the five. Well, it was about 10 meters. We had this general rule that everything that's beyond 10 meters from the actor will be replaced as a CG, which means computer generated element. And the small dots you are seeing in the green, they are just markers for us so that we understand later how the camera has moved, and so we can exactly calculate the camera movement so that we can copy it to the virtual world. And of course, it's very important that I'm always there telling the actor that there is now a door opening, and you need to be aware that it's coming, it's this long, and so they need to also imagine things, which might be a little bit hard sometimes. And for the actors, they are unaware of what's going to be there, and unless I'm trying to explain, but Troll VFX is our new company. We formed that after Iron Sky. We wanted to. Energia Production was actually the company that produced all the visual effects for Iron Sky, but we decided that we want a company that's only concentrating into visual effects. But I'll show you also a couple of how the workflow actually begins. Before the camera is rolling, there is actually happening quite a lot of things. Of course, storyboarding the film, it was really important. It's just drawing the what's going to happen in the shots, and of course we are always referring to those. Well, we didn't have time to shoot motorcycles, too bad. It's kind of a normal thing that you need to make compromises in the film. It's just sometimes you just run out of time, and you have a certain time to use for certain shots, and when the time is up, you have to you have to manage with those shots. So yeah, it's that was all very kind of a it was rough sometimes that you have been planning for a certain thing 3 years and then because camera freezes or something like that, you just don't have the possibility to shoot that, and the moment goes, and then you either fix it in post, which might be really expensive, or you skip it. Yeah, it's I'll show, and of course it was also, here is some full CG elements that we kind of created to how the actors are put there and what kind of movements there are, and then we start to think where we are going to place the green screen, and where will be the separation between live action and the real material and the full CG. We made careful calculations on how tall the green screen needs to be, and we did quite a lot of thinking how the shots will be. Actually, I'm going to show the this was what the Washington character. He escapes from the Nazis, and basically we did this shot by shot, this ugly version, how the scene could go. And this scene actually was executed more or less like this story board or animatic is telling. I'll show you now and there was this. It's also Washington is being hit by the so he falls down. So yeah, and this is this other angle. So basically we can try out different angles and try out lenses to the camera virtually before we are on the set, because the fact is that on the set there, I'll show the some images of the set in Australia, because in Australia we had the privilege of using quite big set. Well, this is the moon set. Basically it was built, the green screen was built there I'll search for the green screen is here, and it's lifted and dropped down, and then there you have your green screen. And it was because we had so many sets, so we needed to have space so that we could continue from different set to different set, and we don't need to build anything because the shooting schedule is quite heavy usually. Here's the moon set. We only had this kind of a small piece there. And I'll show these later, but let's take a look at how the actual final scene worked. Actually, first I'm going to show the how it looked like before we did anything. This is actually the A cut, which means that there were really many things that changed, but in overall it's more or less the same. Yeah. This is kind of how the film began. And of course the film director and the editor needs to make their editorial calls and decisions based on more or less this material, that they don't have the wide landscapes there, and they just need to count on there that there will be something really nice. Let's go to the here it is, the scene.
James, I mean anybody?
Arthur, Sie sprechen doch Englisch. Was hat gesagt?
Hey, what does the brother have to do to get a drink?
Adler.
Okay, here it is.
Right? No. I love me some sauerkraut. Yeah. And,
as you can see, the tracking markers are always visible there in the background, so that we know how the camera is moving.
Farbenduggen. Hey! German words, right? I mean, all cool. You know, it's as if, like, where I come from, we speak German too. You know what I'm saying? Oh! Damn, you're gonna be sorry you did that, white boy.
Nehmen Sie die Hände weg, die Hände weg. Es geht schon. Ergreift ihn. Nein, ergreift ihn.
One small step for man, one giant leap to save my beautiful black behind. Ah!
Yeah. So yeah, it was kind of funny, the guy, because we needed the impact to the actor. So there was this guy with the green outfit and yeah. Not sure if that helped or not, but I want to see it. It was really funny, man. I saw it. Well, yeah, let's and just imagine how much the time they spend constructing this level, and sometimes the information just doesn't go. That it doesn't need to be this big, and sometimes the money goes to somewhere you just don't need to use it. But the Germans really wanted to make everything last, and it was kind of everything was so heavy, and we said that because in Finland people have really kind of because everything is so needs to be done very cheaply here, you cannot build kind of this sturdy sets, and everything needs to be kind of really cardboard and just don't touch it, and it works fine, and in Germany at least. Of course, they didn't know how we are going to use them, because of course visual effects for them is also kind of a little bit magical. What are you going to do there, and all that stuff. So now we are going to check out the scene with visual effects. Oh, and then there was this kind of a one step that we create these very crude versions of the background before, so that the editor can lock down the scenes, that he at least have some kind of understanding what's going to be there. And
hey, sauerkraut. Hey.
So at least you understand something, that if you have a wide shot, you need to see it maybe a little bit longer, that you understand it better. But yeah, it's a kind of very important step in creating the visual effects, that that the film can be locked down. And then hopefully I can find the final So yeah, that was kind of that's in a nutshell the workflow. That there's a lot of pre-planning and thinking before the shooting takes place, and kind of making bad decisions while shooting that might cost you quite a lot of money. And that's why I'm there. I'm usually, whenever there is a visual effect heavy film, I'm there kind of a helping director to make right choices that, yes, you can do that, but if you move camera, it's maybe too expensive. Maybe you should do it like this, and try to avoid this and this. And that's kind of, I'm trying to keep the visual effects on budget while we are shooting the film. That's kind of the what I do mostly nowadays. Of course, then we execute the visual effects and try to match the needs of the and the wishes from the director. And one more example quickly. The George W. Bush, the spaceship, we also did this kind of very ugly. We just copied the one guy, and because we knew that we are going to build the set in this size, so we were able to kind of make an exact copy of the set in computer, and we executed that. I'll show you the couple of images. So yeah, this was the concept for the, well, I think this is the very first phase in visual effect production, when the director says that, hey, I want to kind of have this spaceship that looks like a NASA command center, and there's a lot of tables. And then comes our concept designer, who draws his vision of the set and of the environment. And director says that, yes, this is exactly what I want to see in the film. Because it's much easier to draw something than shoot and do the visual effects and then decide that I don't like this. And here is the what we shot in Australia. Again, we built this part of the and we only could afford a couple of desks, and here we created this is the 3D model. And kind of a little bit more finest. And now there's lights and colors and everything like that. And then we have, then this is the real plate. And what we then did, because we had only two tables, so we, what we learned while doing Star Trek, we just moved the table and swapped the people and shot that. So we shot this table by table, and every table crew had just 2 minutes time, and they were doing these basic movements, shake to the left, shake to the right, shake forward, now clap your hands, and it was very efficient, and the whole crew was completely unaware what's happening and where this is leading. But this was really kind of obvious for us when we were doing Star Trek, that when we are shooting people one by one, and we didn't move camera, but we moved the table. Yeah, here's the build set. So yeah, it's about combining stuff also. It's not always about creating completely new in computer. It's also about kind of duplicating things and copying things. Yes, that was kind of and here's just a quick example of the Götterdämmerung, the bridge of the big Nazi war machine. Here is the shot plate. We built this round thing, piece of set, and here is the 3D model, and this is the final result. And yeah, and we of course added some people here that we shot against green screen here, and just put them to the right places. And it's about, again, kind of a, because you cannot have this big set. Usually, it's not kind of cost efficient to build huge sets like this, especially if you don't have enough money. As that's the fact with filmmaking, always there's not enough money. But yeah, that's kind of a, in a nutshell, visual effects side.
Could I ask what basically decides or when you use computer generated images and when you shoot on location? Because you said that you did this attack scene on the street of Frankfurt. Mm. Why didn't you do it on computer?
Well, some things are much easier and cheaper to do in real life, like a cityscape, kind of if you are on down the street level. There's so many things that are moving and humans cannot be created that easily on computer. Still, even the big Hollywood blockbusters, when they are trying to create full CG, computer-generated humans, they still don't look exactly correct. That's because we are seeing people every day and we know exactly how they move. And if small thing is off by a little bit of margin, then you can say that it's not real. So, but we don't see spaceships every day. So they are much easier to do.
That's right.
So that's basically humans and of course living creatures, they are really difficult to create on CG. Yeah. They can be created, but they really take a long time.
Yes, I would actually like to ask two things about the content of this movie. First of all, would you consider Iron Sky as a diesel punk movie? Because by diesel punk, I mean this relatively new genre of science fiction that is retro-futuristic. Because basically it's a movie about 1930s and 40s, but paradoxically it's also located into the future. So there's this kind of paradox that it is science fiction actually about the past. So would you say that Iron Sky is a diesel punk movie?
Yes, that was, we defined that in the very beginning, that of course the option was to create really, really high-tech UFOs, but because we started from the fact that the Nazis went to the moon in the 40s, and more or less their technological advancements stopped there. They just kept refining the existing stuff, excluding the anti-gravity thing, but all the others were kind of because I think that these spaceships, they began their construction in 70s or 60s, their huge construction line, and they basically didn't change their design that much afterwards. So maybe updated some things, but yeah, the answer is yes. And I think it's visible in the film as well. I have some kind of concept art here, and how the spaceship design also kind of a, just so that you understand, kind of, let's say this is from our art director Jussi Lehtiniemi, and he kind of he has this huge bank of images, of course Google, and but he has also collected everything, and basically he gives these references, these images, to the artist, and that please imitate this look. And then he creates the layout for the spaceship, and so you have something to start with. That this is the look, because we wanted the spaceships to look not so Star Trek-ish. We wanted to look like they could be built kind of during this time, very soon, if not today, and yeah, so. It was very important to set up the look for the diesel punk, and it's very visible in the Iron Sky, especially in the Nazis. And Yeah.
It's really fun moment in the movie when the Nazi doctor finds out a modern mobile phone and he uses that as a replacement for his old like tube-based computers that are as large as a room.
Yeah, so in this concept art they are also visible. The supercomputers are here in this plan.
So basically the Nazis have stuck in the technical level of 1940s.
Something like that.
Yes, yes. So my second question would be, because I'm actually a scholar of German history, and on the first impression, one would say that your theme is a little bit provocative because it deals with Nazis, and I have also some German friends who always tell me that they are a little bit tired to watch all those films about Second World War, because the Germans are of course always villains and the British forces are the heroes. But I think I have feeling that your point of view is really fresh, because there's this carnivalistic touch that actually turns a little bit things upside down. So I think that you also made cooperation with Germans if you were doing this film in Frankfurt. So how did your German fans then react to this this connection with the real history of Germany?
Well, in the beginning of the production, it was actually we knew that we need to find a co-producer from Germany because we need the German actors. And it was very difficult at first to find people who want to be in this production. The producer, he was into this film production right from the beginning, but the distributor companies and the financing structure of the film proved to be quite difficult. And it was because we needed to explain that this film it's done correctly, and we don't make fun of certain things, and basically these are just space Nazis. These are not space Germans. I think that was the kind of we wanted to separate this. Although they are speaking German, they are still not kind of a German people. They are space Nazis.
Yes. So I think we could now take some questions from the audience as well.
Thank you for the presentation. I think what's most fascinating is how you get the people going, like the crowdsourcing and crowdfunding. What do you think was the crucial part in the beginning, like how you got people involved?
I think it's just kind of the long way we have been going, beginning from the Star Trek time, and people, I think they start to think that maybe these guys can do something, that they just don't stop and then just let it go. So I think that's all very important, that the fans trust that we are doing something. I think that's the first thing, and of course giving new stuff all the time, that's also very important. I was doing that while we were doing Star Trek. I quickly noticed that because the team, the other guys, were coming to my place every week, and I always needed to have something new to show to keep their interest and motivation going. And that was kind of that way I motivated Timo and the other guys that this is progressing all the time. It's very important, whatever your project is, that's kind of the crucial thing.
There is no sound in space. Could you imagine a film where there is no sound in space?
Well, then it would also require that there is no music, because the sound effects are coming from the same place as the additional light and the music, because it's coming from somewhere. And but I think, I want to have sounds in space. If it serves the storytelling point, maybe then.
Gustavo.
Hi. Could you tell us something about the score, the music score? If you had some apportation from fans, or you hired a professional yes. composer?
Right from the very beginning, Timo, the director, knew that he wants Laibach to do the score for the film. It's this Slovenian band that has been around ages, and they also kind of have similar history. They are dealing with same kind of subjects and a little bit provocativities, and not everybody likes them, so they provided us a really unique soundtrack, and it fit very well.
I was just wondering that were there many deleted scenes that were fully completed, but then they had to be chopped off? That how did you? Why were they dropped off then if they were completely made?
Of course, there were a lot of deleted scenes, and which was really shame because, in a way, you have wasted your time and resources on those scenes that won't be showing up in the film if they don't serve the story well enough. But we restored a couple of those scenes to the extended, it wasn't the extended version, it was the director's cut, which was released this year, and it's available only in Netflix, actually. It's coming out on DVD as well, and there's all the deleted scenes are more or less there, which were usable.
I could actually ask that, are there any plans to have sequel for Iron Sky?
Yes, there are plans for a sequel, and actually we have already started our crowdsourcing, crowdfunding, and Timo successfully got, I think, about 170,000 US dollars as donations from the fans. Of course, half of that goes to kind of sending out the t-shirts and everything like that. So it's good to remember that when you are doing crowdfunding in Kickstarter or Indiegogo, it's not kind of all yours, because you are going to spend some of that money to send the perks to the fans. And you need to be also very careful that you don't kind of put too good perks. And it's a very important step that now Timo and Tero can arrange, can create the story and the script, because you need to hire a story writer and all that stuff. So it takes, again, money.
Will it take another 7 years?
Well, hopefully not. Of course, I have my own plans, because I still believe that I want to do a new Star Trek at some point, and I have some story ideas, but let's see when it's ready for crowdfunding.
And is there also a video game about Iron Sky?
Yes, there have been a couple of video games, but all of those have been really bad.
Like usually.
I never believed that. They had about 3 months to do the game. But the German co-producer said, yes, it's a very good idea, and yes, let's do this. And fine. And it turned out to be exactly what I said.
What about the board game?
Yeah, that's. I don't know anything about board games, but I think that has been a pleasant surprise. People have really liked it, and but it's not a computer game. But yeah. I think it was much better.
So, what have you been working on after Iron Sky?
I've been actually just... we have this new company called Troll, and we have been just doing commercials and this boring stuff, kind of a... But the good thing is that they pay us money, and I have finally a salary. Monthly salary, and that's also a very good thing after being artist for... all my life. So sometimes you just need to make some money as well to keep on living. But at the same time, it also gives me possibilities to kind of think something new and revisit old things. The Star Trek 10-year anniversary is in 2 years, and maybe we need to do something to celebrate that. Who knows?
Okay, thank you very much, Samuli Torssonen and Veijo Hietala.